Welcome to MCOM second semester research methodology subject video lesson number 19. Today's topic is about the measurement of data and information in research methodology. It is under the unit 2 of your syllabus. I am your teacher, Dr. K.V. Somnath, J.S. College of Commerce, Vatha. Let us go for a brief introduction what actually the measurement is. In our day-to-day life, we are set to measure when we use some yardstick to determine the weight, height or some other feature of physical object. We also measure when we judge how well we like a song, a painting or the personalities of our friends and whom we admire are heroes. We thus measure physical objects as well as abstract concepts. Measurement is a relatively complex and demanding task, especially so when it concerns qualitative or abstract phenomena. Thus, by measurement, we mean the process of assigning numbers to objects or observations, the level of measurement being a function of the rules under which the numbers are assigned. It is easy to measure in respects of objects or concepts that are quantifiable because measurement tools are standardized. The measurement obtained is highly accurate. However, if the concept of abstract is qualitative form, the measurement becomes quite difficult because the measurement tools are not standardized and the results are relatively less accurate. Technically speaking, measurement could be called a process of mapping aspects of domain onto other aspects of a range according to some rule of correspondence. In measuring, we devise some form of scale and then transform or map the properties or features of objects from the domain onto the scale. For example, in case we want to find out the male to female attendance ratio while conducting a study of persons who attend some show, then we may tabulate those who come to the show according to their gender. We can also record yes or no answers to a question as 0 and 1 in this artificial or nominal way. Categorical data, qualitative or descriptive, can be made into numerical data, and if we thus code on various categories, we refer to the numbers we record as nominal data. So nominal data are numerical in name only because they do not share any of the properties of the numbers we deal in ordinary mathematics. Now, there are various types of measurement scales. Now, let us discuss about one by one. The most widely used classification of measurement scales are number 1, nominal scale, number 2, ordinal scale, number 3, interval scale, and number 4, ratio scale. And what is a nominal scale? A nominal scale is simply a system of assigning number symbols to event in order to label them. Such number cannot be considered to be associated with an ordered scale. Further, there is no consequence. The numbers are just convenient labels for a particular class of events and as such have no quantitative value. Nominal scales provide convenient ways keeping track of people, objects and events. One cannot do much with the numbers involved. Nominal scale is the least powerful method of or level of measurement. It indicates no order or distance relationship and has no arithmetic logic or origin. A nominal scale simply describes differences between things by assigning them to categories. Nominal data are thus counted data. Now let us go to ordinal scale. The ordinal scale places events in order, but there is no attempt to make the intervals of scale equal in terms of some group. Rank orders represent ordinal scales and are frequently used in research relating to qualitative phenomena. A student rank it has graduation class involves the use of ordinal scale. One has to be very careful in making statement about scores based on ordinal scales. Ordinal measures have no absolute values, and the real differences between adjacent ranks may not be equal. All that can be said, one person is higher or lower on the scale than other, but more precise comparisons cannot be made. Since the numbers of the scale have only a rank, meaning the appropriate measure of central tendency is median, a percentile or quartile measure is used for measuring dispersion. Now let us go for interval scale. In the case of interval scale, the intervals are adjusted in terms of some rule that has been established as the basis of making the units equal. The unit is equal only in so far as one accepts the assumption on which the rule is based. Interval scales can have an arbitrary zero, but it is not possible to determine for them what may be called an absolute zero or a unique margin. The primary limitation of the interval scale is the lack of a true zero. It does not have the capacity to measure the complete absence of a trait or a characteristic. The Fahrenheit scale is an example of an interval scale and shows similarities in what one can and cannot do while writing it. Now the ratio scale. The ratio scales have an absolute or true zero of measurement. The term absolute zero is not as precise as it was once believed to be. We can conceive of an absolute zero of length, and similarly, we can conceive of an absolute zero of time. The ratio involved does have significance and facilitates a kind of comparison which is not possible in case of interval scale. Ratio scale represents the actual amounts of variables. Generally, all statistical techniques are usual with ratio scales and are all manipulations that one can carry out with the real numbers can also be carried out with ratio scale values. Geometric and harmonic means can be used as measures of central tendency, and coefficient of variation may also be calculated. Thus, proceeding from the nominal scale means the least pre-used type of scale, the ratio scale, which is most precise. The relevant information is obtained increasingly. If the nature of the variables permits, the researcher should use the scale that provides the most precise description. Researchers in physical sciences have the advantage to describe variables in ratio scale form, but the behavioral sciences are generally limited to describe variables in interval scale form, a less precise type of measurement. Now the sources of error in measurement. Where there is a scale, there may be error, or mostly there lies errors. So when we measuring, sometimes there may be errors. So the measurement should be precise and unambiguous in an ideal research study. Thus, objective is often not met with in entirety. The researcher must be aware about the sources of error in measurement. The following are the possible sources of errors in measurement. The first one is a respondent. Most of the times, we go for research, we carry out a questionnaire or a schedule to ask some questions regarding our problem and related to our problem related arena. While asking the questions, most of the times the respondents to whom the questionnaire is designed or a schedule is designed may not respond appropriately, either due to having no time or having no interest or feeling that there is no particular benefit of responding to it. So like that, in many ways, it is a psychological condition. A respondent is a human being. At the same time, a respondent may consider sometimes it is not required, sometimes it is highly required, or sometimes feeling any inability to respond. So like that, some errors may be committed. Sometimes a wrong data and information can also be provided by the respondent. Sometimes we can check it, sometimes we cannot cross-check it. And mostly, the personal related data may be sometimes misquoted or wrong information may be provided. So automatically, there may be an error from the respondent point of view. Now coming to the situational factors. Most of the times, the situation in which either the respondent or the person who carries the measuring instrument or the data information collection instrument may go for obliging the situation, and that may situations may cause some errors and which cannot be put out from the research area. So such type of things may also depend upon the situational factors, the errors may arise. The third one is from the point of view of the measurer. Okay, when once the data is collected and it is edited, and after that proper quantification is done with the help of the machines or human beings, automatically sometimes there may be an error, maybe error by omission or error by commission, like that several errors may arise at the time of measurement by the measurer or the calculator or the processor. So due to that there may be some error in the measurement. And finally, instruments. As I said, the instruments what we use for collecting the data and information, that may sometimes have some minimum error or some error while it is being constructed, either due to not following the standard operating procedures or the construction of the measurement rod is also not due to the standard way of practices. In such a cases also, the results will be erroneous and we cannot rule out the importance or the existence of error in the data. So like that, we have four categories of errors, that is the respondent, situational factors, measurers and instruments. I hope you might have gone through this lesson. I request you to go as many times as possible to think over it and logically understand it and then go for the next lesson. Till then, stay safe and stay protected. Thank you. Thank you very much. All the best.